Welcome to There's Sometimes a Buggy, Irresponsible Opinions About Classic Film. I'm Elise.
I'm Dave. This week, it's the Hollywood Studios Year by Year, Warner Brothers 1939. We'll be discussing The Roaring Twenties and Dust Be My Destiny. And our final segment this week will be Fear and Moviegoing in Toronto. Once again, we saw Splendor in the Grass, so stay tuned. Before we get into the films, we're going to look at the Warner Brothers star contract list from 1939. So here's the panorama of personalities Warner Brothers was offering to its public in 1939. As always, this is Joel W. Findler's patented idiosyncratic three-tiered rating. You either get 1 star, 2 stars, or 3 stars, and in a few instances, 0 stars. And this is all based on Findler's
personal categorization system in his head that we have to guess at.
Right, but it does seem to be, how big of an impact did this person make on a marquee during the entirety of their contract at this particular studio? So not taking into account anything they did anywhere else, but averaging out their appeal over the entire contract. So if they were really popular for a little while and then faded, they might not get 3 stars, etc.
Again, though, this is just Dave extrapolating.
That's right. So here we go. Edward G. Robinson, 3 stars. James Cagney, 3 stars. Betty Davis, 3 stars. Kay Francis, 2 stars. This was her last year at the studio. Paul Muni, 3 stars. Dick Powell, 2 stars. He was about to leave as well. Humphrey Bogart, 3 stars. Relevant to this week's podcast, he was certainly not at that level in 1939. Pat O'Brien, 2 stars. Olivia de Havilland, 2 stars. Errol Flynn, 3 stars. Claude Rains, 2 stars. Anne Sheridan, 2 stars. Jane Wyman, 2 stars. Ronald Reagan, 1 star.
Huh?
And John Garfield, 3 stars.
And yet you have an entire Reagan podcast.
Yes.
He did all of his important work at Warner's, right?
Well, Reagan, he had a 7-year contract. World War II intervened. He came back for the rest of the 40s. In the 50s, though, he was kind of all over the place, and he did some interesting movies elsewhere. It wasn't just at Warner's.
Like Bedtime for Bonzo.
That's right. That was at Universal.
And that was interesting.
I love it. Now, let us turn our attention back to the main event here. And we're going to talk first about Clive Hirschhorn's The Warner Brothers Story. This is what he has to say about The Roaring Twenties. Vouchsafing its authenticity, author, reporter, and columnist Mark Hellinger assured audiences in the opening credits for his story, The Roaring Twenties, that all the characters depicted in this memory of the past were composites of criminals he knew and that the Prohibition incidents were based on fact. The story of a returning First World War veteran who thumbs his nose at society and turns bootlegger after a brief fling as a cab driver. It starred James Cagney as Eddie Bartlett, a mobster, who, when finally on the skids, redeems his tawdry life by sacrificing himself to save the husband of the woman he loves, played by Priscilla Lane. Less violent and more sentimental than some of the studio's earlier ration of crime films, it was tautly directed in a documentary-like fashion by Raoul Walsh, who replaced Anatole Litvak, whose evocation of the era was masterly. Jerry Wald, Richard McCauley, and Robert Rawson wrote the screenplay, with effective roles for Bogart, Jeffrey Lynn, Frank McHugh, and as the nightclub hostess, Gladys George, who replaced Anne Sheridan, who replaced Lee Patrick,
wow,
who replaced Glenda Farrell, exclamation point.
Those would all have brought very different qualities.
Hal B. Wallace produced, with Sam Bischoff as associate. So, The Roaring Twenties, Elise, one of my all-time favorite films. How do you feel about it?
Well, can I start with a more more global question.
Of course.
Regarding this Warner Brothers episode. So I think it was in our last Warner's episode that we did was it last episode that we did the Errol Flynn double feature? Or a Errol Flynn double feature?
Yeah, it was The Sisters and Dawn Patrol.
Right. I remember saying this was a new era for Warner Brothers and that they weren't the same studio from the early 30s, didn't have the same stars, didn't have the same aesthetic. And then I immediately took it back and I was like, well, yes, actually there is a continuity there, but not with this particular star, not with Errol Flynn. He's a divergence. So with John Garfield, kind of as the studio's new James Cagney figure, starting in 1938, and of course Humphrey Bogart is going to move into a similar role very soon. What would you say, looking at these two movies, are the differences between Cagney, starting in the early 30s, and Garfield, starting in the late 30s, as a Warner Brothers protagonist figure, archetypal, or typical figure?
Well, I think one of the things you can definitely say about the Roaring Twenties is that Cagney himself is very different from the way he was often asked to play in the early 30s.
Right, so you can talk about that and the reasons for that, a lot having to do with the code. But it did occur to me watching these two movies that maybe there's no other studio that is, and I don't know if that's because of continuity in oversight, but no other studio that has such a self-awareness of its own history kind of bred into the movies and in the way that they use their stars and character actors.
I'm not sure I would agree with that, because MGM, I think, has a very rich awareness of its own tradition as well. Those are probably the two.
But it seems, again, like I'm saying, at MGM at a certain point there's a stark break and a stark new direction, even though there are still callbacks, explicit references, shout-outs to its past in their movies. Whereas here, well, okay, so for example, Cagney isn't playing the same kind of role that he did in the pre-code era, but so much of what he's doing in this movie calls back to that in a way that the movie, and maybe this has something to do with screenwriter Robert Rawson, who worked on both films, in the way that the movie seems to expect audiences to be aware of. Everything from every time he raises his fist, like he's going to start punching the lights out of somebody. That's one kind of callback. But also the fact, I mean, this combines his working class cab driver persona with his gangster persona, right?
It does, but it brings something entirely new to the mix as well.
Well, a self-consciousness about this figure's history and the studio's history would involve that too.
Yeah, it does. Absolutely. This is a revisionist take on the gangster film explicitly, right? And Warner Brothers is the studio most associated with gangster films. The gangster film for the popular front era, the mature popular front era. The dividing line there and the distinction between the late 30s and the early 30s is that in the early 30s, these nihilistic gangsters, you are supposed to empathize with them to some extent.
Or, I don't know, would you say that's true of Cagney and the Public Enemy?
I think you're supposed to understand that, and they present it this way, this is a problem, right? Maybe you're not supposed to have warm, fuzzy feelings about him because it's kind of impossible, but you're supposed to think, okay, this is happening all over the place. What are we going to do about it?
Now, mostly, of course, Cagney did play characters that you are supposed to have mixed feelings for, but definitely warm and fuzzy are some of them.
Sometimes, yeah, but not as much in the early 30s. That's something that becomes more and more part of what he's able to bring to the screen. The reason for that is that Warner Brothers itself, you know, this is, again, part of my ongoing thesis that I began to forge in college when I wrote papers on Warner Brothers. Things like Public Enemy, I'm a Fugitive from a Chain Gang, this is on the cusp of absolute social breakdown. And this is Warner Brothers addressing a public that is revolutionary, or at least pre-revolutionary. And they are definitely not encouraging it, maybe, because they're still a corporation, but they are tapping into this feeling of absolute nihilism.
What, like the Joker movie?
A little bit, yeah. And once FDR comes in, Warner Brothers does shift. So it's not just the code that makes this happen, right? Yes, the code is part of the story, but even more so, the New Deal and the changes that the Communist Party, the Communist International, implemented in their approach to dealing with the Western democracies completely changes the attitude that a left-wing film will have toward the gangster, right? And
so
towards its public.
this is then what the references are that were quite obscure to me at the end of the movie about this new era that we're entering into?
Absolutely.
So Rawson is intending the Roaring Twenties as a kind of allegory then.
Of course he is. And Robert Rawson, you know, we're not just making this up or guessing. Robert Rawson was a communist.
Right? Yes.
There's no doubt about it. And this is the kind of thing that was getting people blacklisted later. Both of these films.
And of course, he did get blacklisted.
Yeah, he made a comeback through dubious means, as always. But that's neither here nor there. His politics in the 30s were unalloyed communist international. And what that meant was finding a socialist tradition in the American grain and presenting it to people in a way that would be palatable so that the mission could be furthered through elections.
So why don't you talk about how this movie works as an allegory before we get into its dramatic interest?
Right. Well, it's the personal story of one gangster who is a good man. We like him from the start. We see he's a tough guy, but a fair guy. It's all there in that first scene in the foxhole where you meet your three characters, three representatives.
It's almost sort of a Man Who Shot Liberty Valance set up here in that with Cagney as the John Wayne figure and
Jeffrey Lynn,
the lawyer, as the Jimmy Stewart. Well, a lawyer in both cases as the Jimmy Stewart figure.
Yeah.
But what does Humphrey Bogart bring to it?
Humphrey Bogart is Liberty Valance, clearly.
Oh, right.
If you want to do that, he's right there. He's a complete maniacal sadist.
Yeah,
right?
He's a sociopath.
Yeah, character interplay in that foxhole. You know, everything is done for maximum effect. It's not a subtle film.
No.
But it's so beautifully done.
It is a nice moment when Humphrey Bogart shoots that teenager, and then 1 second later, randomly and arbitrarily, the war is called off.
He won't be 16. But even more so, right, when they're talking to each other, you get a sense of how these characters are going to develop and how they're going to relate to each other all the way through the unfolding years. You've got Jeffrey Lynn suffering heart palpitations, which anyone would when bombs are bursting all around them, and he is not afraid to let it show.
Yeah, and Cagney likes that.
Yeah, Bogart rides him for having no heart, and Cagney's like, shut up!
And heart means courage here.
Yeah.
Because definitely Bogart has no heart.
No. Cagney, though, he says, I don't like tough guys and big mouths. Of course we're all afraid. What's wrong with you, right? If you're not afraid, you're a maniac. And of course, Bogart is a maniac.
Yeah.
So all of that is nicely set up. Jeffrey Lynn is a rich kid. He was on his way to a legal career and got sucked into the last year of the war.
And then it is interesting, an interesting development, unexpected, that he gets sucked into illegal activities under Prohibition.
Yeah, we get to America, and very important, right? People often forget about this nowadays, but it would have been something everyone would have known about in 1939. There was a mini depression after World War I, right? So the Roaring Twenties, in terms of high living, that's not until like the mid to late 20s. And of course, a lot of it has to do with this consumer boom in the stock market.
And that's the flapper era.
Yeah, but immediately after the war, there was this depression and there were jobs lost and there were waves of potential radical activity and strikes. And this is where you get the first Red Scare. The real Red Scare, you know, the 50s Red Scare was sort of a culture war type thing with people getting canceled, which was terrible, and it had a really malicious effect. It was probably more important in the long run in its ideological function. But the first Red Scare, people got killed by feds and thrown in jail for long periods of time, and that's not really what happened in the 50s. It was more, let's take down some high-profile Hollywood people.
Ending careers, yeah.
Exactly.
So, including John Garfield, hounded to death.
Yeah. One of the amazing things about this film is how it uses the montage technique. So many different...
I wouldn't exactly call this a documentary-style film. I'd like to challenge that.
It is in a way, right? And it's intended to be so, right? There's the March of Time voice guide.
At moments, but certainly not throughout.
No.
But it did... It seems like a movie that would have had... The way it takes us inside of this world and shows us how it works, it does seem like a movie that would have had a lot of influence on Martin Scorsese.
Oh yeah, absolutely. But this is what I was talking about with Babes in Arms a couple weeks ago. ago, right? Which was also made in 1939 and has that quick look back at the 20s. And there they were talking about vaudeville and the entertainment industry. And here they're talking about the people that would have been sitting in the seats watching the vaudeville.
Right. Well, yeah, it's the end of a decade. So right. People are looking back.
It's a look back, not at the 30s, but at the 20s, right? The immediately preceding decade and all the crazy things that happened there leading up to the Great Depression.
Right.
And the repeal of the Volstead Act.
Which is?
Well, the act that enforced prohibition. Mm. Cagney can't get his old job back, and he's one of the people that comes back a year after the war, right? They make a point of that. So he doesn't even get to enjoy all the parades and stuff. He's stuck policing the Rhineland, which was something that was done, right? They occupied a big part of Germany, and France kind of took over and continued to do that. By the time he gets back, everyone just thinks he's dead.
Right, and that's the basis of a joke with his friend, is showing up there like he's in a dream with one of our
Frank McHugh
favorite character actors from Warner Brothers.
He's in both of these films. He's got a great role in this one. I love Danny. He's just been trying to get on with his life, driving a cab. When they finally sit down and talk after Cagney surprises him, he talks about all the, and it's pretty amazing, right, that this is a movie, this character is very sympathetic. He's a draft dodger, right? I mean, he didn't have to run to Canada because he just ran the old army game and pretended to have all these different sicknesses, and he was working up to a heart problem if he needed to.
Yeah, this is some interesting stuff that Rawson got into the screenplay.
There's so much in this film.
How was he managing to do this, do you imagine, under the code?
You could criticize World War One under the code.
Oh, that's true. We're not, yeah, World War One is kind of distant at this point.
It's distant, and half the country is non-interventionist in World War Two as well. And in some part, because they realized World War One was a sham that they never should have gotten involved in.
Do you know where Rawson ends up on that? Because some leftists were very pro-interventionist within the next couple of years.
Well, of course, Rawson was interventionist against the fascists.
Yeah.
But World War One, there was no reason to fight it. No thinking person could possibly think there was.
Yeah, I'm just making the distinction of saying that it's a conservative position at this point to be non-interventionist in World War Two, but you're saying that...
But you could get away
but
with...
But you're saying that, yes, you could criticize conscription with a World War One setting in a popular film.
Yeah, you can have a very likable character who cheats the government out of his services, his military services.
Right.
I wouldn't say there are no consequences for him, because he does get brutally murdered later on.
But yeah, that's
it's
true.
Not because he is a draft dodger. Cagney tries everything he can to just go back to the way he had been living before. He tells everyone he doesn't want any trouble. He's had some. Presumably he wound up in reform school or something like that, right? Like a lot of Warner Brothers heroes. None of that's dwelled on.
He's talked about wanting to work his way up to having his own car mechanic business. And he just wants a quiet life now. And we do also find out that, I guess, Humphrey Bogart's character owns a saloon when it's legal.
Yeah, so his family owned a saloon. Right? And that is a crucial little bit of dialogue there. So he is certainly not a cultured individual, but he comes from like the petty bourgeoisie.
Mm-hmm.
The sergeant that he hates used to work for them and stole money out of the till. And Bogart hates him for that too. You know, they've got just a bad dynamic because the sergeant is using his power over him and it's going to wind up getting him killed many years later in a robbery. So Cagney, he's just doing what he can to adjust. And, you know, we get lots of little snippets of things like what got soldiers through World War One. In some cases, it was letters from home from women that volunteered to just hep up the troops. And he's got this picture he's been carrying around with him since France of a girl that lives in Mineola. And he finally decides, you know, this is what he needs. He needs to go out to Long Island and see this woman.
But it turns out she just had a lot of makeup on in the picture and looked about 5 years older than she is.
Exactly. It's quite a hilarious scene.
It is a very weird development that their relationship has, where she clearly has a teenage crush on this idea of a soldier that she is willing to pursue in some form, like by socializing with him when he gets back. And he's, of course, not at all, because he wants to fuck her and he's not interested in fucking a teenager. He's going to just put that on the back burner for a few years, and during those few years she completely loses interest in him.
Right. Yeah, well, I mean, he never even thinks he's gonna see her again. It's just a fluke, right?
Yeah, I guess that's true. So he's not obsessed with her from the beginning, but he's obsessed with her pretty quickly when she shows up again in his life.
Sure, well, once he sees her as an adult, as Priscilla
Lane. There is a line that indicates, pretty funny line, line as he's exiting this meeting with this teenager, "You'll never know how I suffer," that indicates he's been doing a lot of masturbation over that photo while he was at war.
Could be, and he's been defending it against everyone trying to grab it from him. So that's a very important photo, and now everything back of it has kind of been a little bit tarnished. I just find that whole scene hilarious. Frank McHugh is great in it too, and Cagney's like, "The more I think about this, the more I think you just shouldn't be here at all."
And Priscilla Lane doing her schoolgirl routine.
Yeah, she's great.
She comes skipping into the room.
"I got an A in algebra." So she's a middle class kid, right? This is not a person that his path would have crossed with in his grease monkey days.
So another important character note, or I don't know, screenplay note, is that Cagney does have a legit job at the time he decides to go into bootlegging.
Well, yeah, he decides that he's going to split the cab with McHugh. So they drive it 12 hours on, 12 hours off. And that's what they're doing. And he's making ends meet, but...
but not a lot of, I don't know, I guess there wouldn't be the same opportunity to work up that he was hoping for.
Well, clearly not.
You can't work your way up in the cab business?
I don't know.
I think the highest you get is owning your own cab.
I think that's about it. Yeah. Just a freak occurrence. And one of his passengers gets out, has a bunch of packages. He's going across the street. He's like, "Hey, buddy, you want to do me a favor? Bring this package into Panama. Get 12 bucks. So he does. And of course, he doesn't know what he's doing. He draws too much attention to himself. The prohis get a hold of him. He's hauled into court.
It's actually Panama who gets him started in the bootlegging.
Well, yeah, it all develops, right? They have this weird meet cute. He gets her into trouble, but gets her out of it by thinking quickly and making sure not to implicate her. He's stuck, and he's sentenced to 60 days or a $100 fine. He doesn't have the fine, and she disappears, and it looks like he's just going to be stuck in jail for 60 days. And of course, this is something that is still going on for petty offenses. If you have $100, just pay it. If not, you get locked up for a couple months.
So do you think this would have been more of a viable triangle if Anne Sheridan had played this role instead of Gladys George? Gladys George is actually younger than Cagney.
Gladys George is beautiful.
You think so?
She
strikes me as over the hill in this role.
Fine, slightly, but she's terrific. She's so good in this movie.
Oh, she's good, perfect. But she doesn't radiate sexuality to me the way Anne Sheridan would.
No, it would have been different, for sure. And this is an interesting auteurist aspect to it. You've got Raoul Walsh. He's one of the greatest exponents of this kind of lopsided love triangle. Think of High Sierra. Think of Strawberry Blonde.
Also, though, Warner Brothers loves the love triangle, the lopsided love triangle in general.
Well, they do. It is a big part of Four Daughters and Daughters Courageous as well, but I find that...
Casablanca.
Yeah, but this is a slightly more Raoul Walsh-ish love triangle. It's very similar to High Sierra, although Priscilla Lane is made into a much more sympathetic figure than Joan Leslie is.
Much more. Yeah, and I mean, if Anne Sheridan had played the role, it would have seemed more like High Sierra, where the whole time you're just like, why on earth isn't he interested? Doesn't he reciprocate this woman's feelings? And it would have been more, there would have been more emphasis on just the fact that he identifies with her too much. Like, that's very clear in High Sierra. What he sees in this other girl is escaping his own shame at being a criminal.
A new life. Exactly. And it's the same thing here.
It is, but there just seems like he got that even tauter, that type of triangle in High Sierra.
Right. Well, here, you know, the balance is very different, because really you could see this movie as Gladys George's story in a way, right? I mean, she's the last one standing at the end and delivers the valedictory.
But what is her future?
It's not good.
And she's the one who sends him to die, just like she sends him into bootlegging in the first place. There's nothing else left for you. You clearly don't want to set up with me. And even if you did, what are we going to do? We're losers now.
Yeah.
I noticed this on this viewing that there are all these scenes where he's patting her hand while he's looking at Priscilla Lane. Does that indicate, do you think, like some kind of unconscious interest in her, even as he's fixated on Priscilla Lane?
Well, the line is very blurred there, right? She's his best friend, clearly.
Yeah, but hand patting your best friend, like I feel like there's something more here.
Yeah, I think so too. I think it's very confused in his mind.
And I do love the way Gladys George plays this all. Like, she is emotionally invested, but at the same time standing outside of it and analyzing it all.
Yeah, I think it's a miraculous bit of casting, actually, and no one loves Anne Sheridan more than I do, but I prefer this, I'm sure, to what would have happened with anyone else in this role. And Warner Brothers doesn't particularly do very well by Gladys George in any other movie I've seen. You know, Maltese Falcon is a pretty thankless role. She's Miles Archer's wife, Iva, that Bogart's just trying to shoo out of his office all the time. But this is just...
Well, she's in Best Years of Our Lives.
Oh, she's in other great movies.
But
right?
Not
Valiant. Valiant is the Word for Carrie is an amazing movie.
Yeah.
That's not a Warner Brothers movie either. I don't even know if she was under contract, but she seems to have been for a little while here, because otherwise, why is she in Roaring Twenties and Maltese Falcon so close together in years? He gets his introduction to the whole business through her, right? She bails him out. We have the big scene where they go into the paint store. We see the secret world, the speakeasy behind the facade. And she says, you know, look, this is easy money. This is what I think you should do. I don't want to hear a story about you killing yourself. So I think I should help you get set up in the booze business. She clearly isn't too worried about the legal consequences. Panama, we should say, everyone talks about this, but I think it is important. She is based on a real person, Texas Guinan.
Okay.
And Texas Guinan is what Phyllis Diller is playing in our Fear and Moviegoing.
Oh, okay.
Right? That character, very briefly, character in Splendor in the Grass, but it's the same template.
Right. I was going to say, when we mentioned late 20s and flappers, that it was going to be relevant again for Splendor in the Grass.
Panama, she's an entertainer more than anything, right? She wants to run a bar, entertain her customers, build a name for herself. The actual Texas Guinan even appeared in some movies, but her patter was exactly this, right? Like, hello, suckers! Just a lot of ironic talk about how they're going to fleece you and you're going to enjoy it.
If Phyllis Diller is playing her, I wonder if the real Texas Guinan was not particularly conventionally attractive?
No, she was. So that's a different take on the Texas Guinan figure, I think. I mean, they never call her Texas Guinan in Splendor in the Grass. She's just a figure that's kind of similar because of her patter.
Right.
Then we get more montages and just seeing Cagney build up his business. He acquires a fleet of cabs to help with his distribution and cover his trail. And he's got his own sort of emporium where they create the fake hooch and give it the
bathtub
gin treatment. Yeah. I mean, they're getting it from a supplier at first, and then they try to up the price, and he's like, I got a bathtub too. I can make this tiger sweat myself. I pretty much know every line of dialogue to this film because I've seen it so many times.
Getting back to the allegory, though, so something very different from the Scorsese gangster movies. Those seem to be a criticism of a later form of capitalism, or just a criticism of capitalism, in which case, what do you think Rawson is doing with Cagney's actual business? What do you think his position on it is, because Cagney remains a sympathetic figure.
Sure. Well, Cagney is just trying to keep up with the Joneses, and as he says at one point, you know, this is a corporation, we're making money. He is on a parallel track with other corporations that were doing boffo business in the 20s.
And I guess what I mean about Scorsese's gangster movies being a criticism of capitalism is that they do just seem like the gangsters belong to an era, the 80s and 90s, where capitalism was like overtly psychotic in the United States.
Well, I think it's always been overtly psychotic. I mean,
true, but from the Reagan era on, supposedly defined leftists and liberals were hyper aware of that side of things.
So was Robert Rawson's generation aware of what capitalism was like in the 20s. Right.
But we need to go back to originally the gangster is a sympathetic outsider of a sort, although sometimes, as you point out, also a nihilist.
Well, almost always, right? In those classic early gangster films, so Scarface, Public Enemy, Little Caesar, none of those guys are anything but nihilists.
I guess I'm thinking of Robert Warshaw's famous gangster as tragic figure, in that even if they are nihilists, they are still seen as participating in capitalism and therefore victims of it.
Well, yeah, of course. They certainly are, right?
Yeah, they are obeying the injunction to have success, basically, but they're doing it outside of the law because they don't have access to
Yale.
The means, yeah.
Right, and that's exactly what all of those movies are like, right? Scarface, it's the world is yours. Little Caesar, it's all about you're getting ahead. He's an Italian immigrant. There's no other way, right? And same thing with Tom Powers in Public Enemy.
But the Scorsese movies seem to lose that sympathy and just be overtly about, no, you're just psychotic. This whole system you're caught up in, this system of achieving success is just psychotic.
Well, come on. No, that's too simplistic, because we do also see their point at times.
We do, do see their point. Yeah, we absolutely do. But also the sociopathy is so much more writ large.
But then on the other hand, look, Goodfellas is about a character, Ray Liotta's character, who just doesn't want to be a working stiff. And none of us do, right? So that's the point. He's not psychotic.
No, but he's certainly not sympathetic. So getting back to this movie.
Right.
He's you identify with him, but the movie doesn't make him into a sentimental figure. So getting back to this movie, why is Cagney being portrayed in this particular way at this particular moment as this sentimental figure?
Right. Well, the movie is saying, this is you. This is the average voter who should be thinking about bringing in a communist government. And this is what the government during the 20s was doing to people. And this is what it was pushing people toward, right? Succeed at any cost or else get trampled underneath.
So it's the exact same idea, but with a more sympathetic perspective.
Right, with a more pointed Marxist message, I think.
Okay, yeah, that makes sense.
Because there's nothing about Cagney's psychology that indicates that he wants to hurt anyone. None of that, right? He's not giving in to any kind of urges like that. He just wants a good life for himself, and this is the only way he can get it. And he kind of stays on that path throughout, right? He never has like a moment where he just goes too far, which is what you often get in this kind of story. No, here he just stays on top by basically being someone that the other gangsters feel like they can trust. The only thing that ruins it is the crash and Bogart, a weasel behind the scene that starts working against him. But it's the crash and it's the new era that comes in that also just makes him irrelevant. And that's certainly a big part of what the movie's message is.
Right, because then you're saying that Cagney is supposed to represent the average voter, but also Priscilla Lane is supposed to represent the average voter in this new and friendly Popular Front era.
Yeah, to some extent. But I think another thing that the movie is saying, and it's definitely drawing a parallel between World War I and the Tommy gun era, right? It's saying society told all these young men, grab a gun and go kill people. And basically, not as directly, but for all intents and purposes, it said the same thing on the home front to Cagney's generation and people in Cagney's class. And this is what the movie's thesis on the 20s and the Prohibition era is, right? You could take issue with it. I'm not sure that it's the most nuanced approach, but it's the most incendiary and it's the one that has the best propaganda value, I think, right? So
the movie is saying goodbye. It's saying goodbye to this gangster figure who, in order to usher in a new era of, I guess even the bourgeoisie are going to want communism, as you're saying.
Well, yeah, we're all going to work together to bring about a better world and a better United States, first of all.
Right. So the nihilistic figure has to end because he's too alienating to the common person.
Right, and you don't need to fight this hard anymore against the powers that be because there's a little bit of a foothold, thanks to the New Deal and the Wagner Act and other things that are protecting working people at least a little bit. With that, you can move onward and upward. And of course, that's the message of the Popular Front. It totally failed, but that's what they were trying to instill in people.
And Bogart is just a sociopath who would have never hurt anybody if his business hadn't been made illegal, I guess.
Probably not. I mean, he did get a taste for murder in World War I. We get that scene right at the end after the armistice is signed where he says, you know, I like this. I think I'll take it home with me. And he's speaking about his gun.
Well, we've seen that in other movies like that James Whale World War I movie, the idea that they put the gun in our hands and now we're going to, normal people have been converted into nihilist revolutionaries.
Or counter-revolutionaries.
Exactly, that's what I mean. Revolutionaries or counter-revolutionaries.
Yeah, exactly. It's an important fact that people had to keep in mind. There are a lot of people in American society at that time that were trained to kill people. A lot more than...
Yeah, I'd really hate it if that was happening right at this particular moment. That would be bad.
Well,
I can't even imagine.
I mean, things are bad right now, but just imagine if there was mass conscription and all of these incels were inducted into the army for a few years and came back. Yeah, it would be even worse than the horrors that we're dealing with right now. You know, a lot of the rest of it, it's not like a surprising story.
No.
Kind of goes the way...
There's really...
It's a tragedy.
There's no dramatic tension, really. I have a problem with that. There is an amazing action sequence.
The shootout in the restaurant?
Yeah, that's incredible. That's incredible the way Walsh shoots at. It's really visceral and interesting employment of point of view. Very artful.
Raoul Walsh is one of the great directors, and of course action is a big part of his toolkit, but sentimentality and evocation of the past, also very important, one of the greatest at this. Witness The Strawberry Blonde, which is even greater than The Roaring Twenties, possibly, but not so much action in that one. That scene, it does have our friend of the show, Paul Kelly. Do you remember him? The guy that plays Nick Brown, the opposing gangster that's shoving the clothesline of spaghetti in his mouth.
Oh, that was great. That was a great scene.
Yeah, and that's when Cagney, again...
What is he the friend of the show for? What have we seen him in?
Probably one of the most memorable suite of scenes in any film is his performance in Crossfire, where he's the liar.
Oh my god, no, this guy is a character actor. He can just make an impression.
Yeah, and we've talked about him before, right? Because he's in Side Streets, that one with Aline McMahon.
Yes, so he's the leading man in that.
He is, yeah, and he had quite a life. We've definitely mentioned him before. He did go to jail for manslaughter. He's a man who lived, in some respects, the gangster life that he's portraying on here. And he's got just some wonderful little moments, right? When he's kicking everyone out of the restaurant.
Yeah.
Past is bad for you. Puts pounds on the wrong places.
Yeah. And and you stay here to the old couple.
Yeah, the priest. Yeah.
Yeah.
Or the minister, I guess. That shootout is incredible. Just so many great individual moments in this film. It's shot by Ernest Haller. It looks beautiful.
Yeah. Every Warner Brothers major film looks extraordinary.
Yeah, they didn't really skimp on the photography.
Like, I cannot actually tell the difference. Okay, we saw these on a computer screen. We did not see them in the theater, but I couldn't spot the difference between this and James Wong Howe's cinematography. That's how good the house style at Warner's is.
Well, they're both brilliant cinematographers. It's kind of got a little bit of everything, though, this movie. It's definitely got the action. It's got the politics. It's got comedy quite a lot. It's very funny. It's not just Robert Rawson writing this screenplay, though, we should mention. There's Wald and Macaulay, who were expert comedy writers as well.
Right.
They wrote Torrid Zone, which is a great Cagney movie as well. Another adaptation of The Front Page, but set in revolutionary Central America. And they wrote They Drive By Night.
What this really is, though, although it uses and deconstructs and puts the gangster figure in a new context and does all of these interesting things with the gangster movie, it's not a gangster movie. And that's one thing that I find interesting about it, but also, I don't know, for some reason have trouble with as a viewer. It's a male melodrama. And we've seen Cagney do this before.
Yeah, it's amazing. Why is that bad?
I don't know. I just always feel like I go in with a certain set of expectations and then it's actually a completely different movie.
Yeah, you get something even better. I love this so much more than the early 30s gangster movies.
Do you?
Of course.
Yeah.
I guess you don't, though.
I don't know. I don't know how I feel about it. It's not, you know, it's not a favorite genre of mine, but I usually enjoy it one way or the other in the 30s movies and here as well. I mean, in the early 30s movies and here as well, but okay, but what am I saying? I'm saying it's not a gangster movie. It is a male melodrama. What do I mean by that? Well, because it's really all about this love triangle and Cagney's self-sacrifice.
Yeah, absolutely. It is. Cagney and Walsh revisited this with a happier ending for the Cagney character in The Strawberry Blonde, but it's the same idea, right? This is a guy in Cagney showing no vanity, right? Playing a guy that just gets completely rejected for Jeffrey Lynn. Right, who I like Jeffrey Lynn, and we've seen him in some great movies, and he has a really important part in The Four Daughters. Not so much in Daughters Courageous, he's more just a goofball in that one, but he's very likable when he's supposed
but
to be.
But you do believe that this is a better choice for Priscilla
of
Lane,
course.
And that she never, once she meets the real Cagney, she never ever has any kind of romantic interest in him.
No, she just finds him a fascinating figure. She also can use his help, right? But she's not just using him, and he knows that, even though he accuses her of that at certain points. His enthusiasm just carries her along in certain ways early on, but she never lets it get beyond a certain point because she doesn't have that feeling for him.
Yeah.
It's a great showcase for Cagney to do some totally unexpected emoting. One of my very favorite scenes ever in Cagney's career is the scene where he knocks Lloyd down.
Oh, I was just going to say.
And then he's like, sorry. sorry, kid. Yeah,
Yeah, I was just going to say, actually, Cagney is so extraordinary in this movie, but I was trying to think, well, what is a scene that illustrates that? And yes, that is the one.
That's the one.
That acting, the acting he does in that scene, and very understated, right?
So incredible. It should have won him the Oscar.
Yeah.
Sadly, no. He gets his Oscar for Yankee Doodle Dandy, which is a totally different thing.
No, that's just damned impressive.
It really is. He just gives you everything in that scene.
I don't know.
He's angry. He is pissed off about a world. Someone like this bland lawyer guy is going to win every time over him in the emotional sweepstakes. He does.
From the beginning.
Yeah, of course he does. Everybody likes Jeffrey Lynn.
Maybe I just have a problem with the movie because it is so, I guess it's very painful.
It is.
He's like Millie Teal or something. It's like Wings of the Dove in a gangster movie.
It's never going to work out for him.
No, he's just, and even she, like Densher falls in love with her after she's dead. And like Cagney doesn't even get that. He just has Gladys George mourning him.
Right.
In a Pieta.
Absolutely.
And okay, that is stunning drama, that death scene. That's like got to be the greatest movie death scene.
Well, it's oft quoted for sure. He used to be a big shot.
Well, no, I just mean the whole way it's filmed.
It is. It's incredible.
And those steps.
And Cagney, we've talked at various points
and
about
the fall. How did he do that fall?
Well, he's a dancer.
That's just an incredible fall.
Yeah, up and down the stairs. But yeah, and we've talked at various points about actors who are willing to appear in a very disheveled state. And Cagney enters that sweepstakes here because he looks fucking awful in that.
Well, he's on a bender after he goes to their bourgeois home and meets their utterly obnoxious child. I don't know what this means in terms of the Popular Front.
Well, I agree. It seems like, what, he gave it all up for this? Like, this is... And Priscilla Lane, too. As much as we like Jeffrey Lynn, her life looks terrible to me, right? She's just a housewife.
Maybe this is why the Popular Front fails, because Rawson hates the bourgeoisie so much.
Maybe. Because Priscilla Lane's arc, right? She's an artist. She wants to be a singer. That's what she wants to do from her childhood. And she gets to do it. And because it acquires some unsavory associations, because she's been singing in nightclubs where people are getting shot occasionally, she just retreats back to Long Island, right? And becomes a mom.
This is a new era where we're going to have a much better America where everyone can be bourgeois and hateful.
Yeah, exactly. You know, that is part of it, right? And I don't think it's accidental. I don't think that we're supposed to...
Well, I mean, this could be the movie's dramatic sense conflicting with its political sense.
No, not necessarily. I'm not sure about that. I don't think Robert Rawson thinks this is the ideal life, right? But it's what Cagney is going to have this feeling of angst about. He doesn't want it, and they joke about that, right?
No, I'm just holding you to saying that this new era that's being ushered in is the Popular Front era that has to reject the nihilistic gangster.
But it doesn't have to embrace the life that they're living in Long Island either, raising...
Do you think it has to be more dialectical, like thesis, antithesis, synthesis?
Exactly. Another thing that this movie is a musical, right? It has a lot of musical numbers in it. And Priscilla Lane does an amazing job, I think.
Yeah.
She's got a great voice. And she was a band singer before she came to Hollywood. And it is kind of a shame that she didn't appear in more musicals because she's got kind of an Alice Faye kind of voice.
It's a little bit husky, yeah.
Yeah, it's really good. And her numbers are excellent and they're really beautifully staged. And there's some tension going on some of the time. Her audition scene is so memorable too, right? Where she's, you talked about it already, where Cagney is grabbing Gladys George's hand while he's listening to this and kind of vaguely threatening the bar owner.
He's paying no attention.
I'd be interested to see what people out there think. It may not be for everyone, I guess, but to me this is...
No, I think it probably is for everyone, but it's just one of my favorite films. I certainly enjoy watching it.
It's just about as good as Warner Brothers gets for me, in this line anyway. You know, 1939, I'm often arguing against 1939 as the greatest year, but for Warner Brothers, I'd probably still pick 1941, but you've got Roaring Twenties and Dark Victory both coming out in 1939. So.
Well, I just in general think the apex of studio era movies for me is probably Warner Brothers late 30s to early 40s.
For sure, that continuum, absolutely. If it's not 1941, it's somewhere right around there. Yes, the thesis of this film...
Yeah, I've been like grilling you on that. I've been trying to make you consistent about what the characters represent and what the thesis is, although it probably isn't that cut and dried.
I think what it's saying is that the 1920s and the era of rampant laissez-faire capitalism that preceded the New Deal pretty much broke all of the working class people in America and turned them into potential evolutionary dead ends, right? Who are never going to really be able to play a positive role in the creation of a new socialist society. And Cagney isn't, right? He's just sitting there drinking himself to death, talking about getting back on top again. He's not someone who's going to listen to a Marxist soapbox preacher.
But the movie doesn't seem very hopeful about, is it hopeful about this obnoxious bourgeois family embracing these ideals?
I think it is idealistic about what can come out of the crisis. Chrysalis of the New Deal. I don't think it's saying this family is what everything is going to be like. I just think it's saying that the people like Eddie Bartlett in 1939, we have to catch them before they kill too many people and are completely broken and are unable to contribute in the future. And of course, that's exactly what Just Be My Destiny is about. That's why I wanted to pair these two, because Roaring Twenties is outlining the problem and Just Be My Destiny is showing us the solution.
Okay, well, we'll talk about that next. So, continuing with your thought, how is John Garfield the solution? And you never did answer my question about what, and this might be a good moment to bring it up again, what do you think Cagney versus Garfield represent in terms of the studio and in terms of American society or the studio's perspective on American society?
Yeah, we'll definitely get into all of that. However, I do want to read the Clive Hirschhorn review. So, Dust Be My Destiny. John Garfield was understandably unhappy about his role in Dust Be My Destiny, for it was yet another in the studio's seemingly inexhaustible supply of social melodramas concerning the sorry plight of the underprivileged.
I bet John Garfield hated those parts.
In this instance, Garfield, after being released from prison for a crime he did not commit, is arrested for vagrancy and sent to work on a farm. But even here, fate is against him, and, after falling in love with the stepdaughter of the farm's drunken foreman, he is accused of killing the man in a fight. At his trial, Garfield's attorney uses his client as a sociological symbol to demonstrate the sad circumstances which force a life of vagrancy on men and women from the other side of the tracks. Though excessively predictable, Robert Rawson's screenplay, from a story by Jerome Odlum, was full of quality, and the performances of Billy Hallop, Bobby Jordan, Priscilla Lane, Frank McHugh, and Charles Grapewin were first class. It was directed by Lewis Seiler for associate producer Lou Edelman. So that's kind of a mixed bag there. At the end of the day, Hirschhorn does describe it as first class, but he seems to find it a little tiring.
Apparently, from what I see here on Wikipedia, the reception, this seemed to be what many contemporary reviewers were also saying, this Warner Brothers formula is getting tiresome.
It's crazy because this is a totally unique movie.
And is there some idea out there that John Garfield didn't like the types of roles he was cast in?
I have no idea. There may be some biographical basis for that. I haven't read.
Who knows? I would, given his politics and his theater background, I would think he would have been very happy with the types of roles that he was being cast in.
Certainly this one, this movie is incredible. And this is maybe the easiest case to make for the studio as auteur, right? Because Lewis Seiler...
No, there's another easy case. Oh, you might disagree with this, but this is my thesis about the studio, once it's hitting its stride in the late 30s, is that it no longer needs important directors. It's just generating its own top quality product somehow, just by the whole collaborative effort. And my examples are from women's pictures, actually reaching into the late 40s. The Curtis Bernhardt Possessed, which is a masterpiece, and so is now Voyager, and neither of them have particularly distinguished directors. They're not bad directors, Irving Rapper and Curtis Bernhardt, but...
I would still put those guys in a higher bracket than Lewis Seiler. I mean, he's a very competent director, but I don't have any sense of his personality whatsoever.
And the only Warner Brothers can do this. It's just mind-blowing.
And this is a combination of incredible left-wing script from Robert Rawson. He seems to be the only person that worked on this screenplay.
Cinematography.
James Wong Howe, incredible work as a cinematographer. And the actors, right? The people that Warner Brothers could bring to bear on a story like this are just matchless.
Now, this is the third and, I think, final pairing of Lane and Garfield, because she's going to leave pictures and, well, she continues to have a picture career, but not for that long after this.
Right. Priscilla Lane's trajectory, things are going gangbusters in 1938 with the four daughters, and she starts getting cast in a lot of other things. 39, a big year, obviously, Roaring Twenties and this, and a couple of other movies too. She got into some fights with the studio by the early 40s, and I think Three Cheers for the Irish was one that she really didn't like, which I agree with. It's a dumb movie. But she's in some other movies that are pretty fun, but maybe she was expecting to start getting Betty Davis quality. Yeah.
It does sound like that was what she was after. And based on her courtroom scene here, maybe they should have given her a chance.
She's a wonderful actor. There's no question about it. You know, a very early favorite in my life and someone I've never lost.
Yeah, you had to really work on me to get me interested in Priscilla Lane, but I'm sold now. And I guess there were inherent limitations that would have taken a particular movie. Like, she'd have to have been really cast against type in order to break out of this girl next door thing that she had going, right?
Yeah, and I guess that probably never happened, right? If you think about...
They just keep using her in the same way, but with more limitations on it than the way they use, say, John Garfield.
There's a wide variation on how horny she is in the film.
She's always pretty horny, though.
She is. She is. Very wholesomely horny. One of the things I appreciated about her as a teenager, and still do. She has some big successes after leaving Warner Brothers, most notably Saboteur with Hitchcock. And, well, Arsenic and Old Lace, it was made at Warner Brothers, but it came out after she'd basically retired because of the delay that was in the contract because of the play. They couldn't release it till the play was done, its run on Broadway. She did make a comeback in the late 40s, and those movies are pretty fun too. And she's got that great Jack Benny comedy, The Meanest Man in the World, that was made at Fox. But yeah, her career is kind of over by the mid-40s.
By her choice.
Yeah, she quit to raise kids.
Yep.
Just like her character in the Roaring Twenties.
Yep.
Hopefully they were better kids than that little brat, that genocidal little brat.
She was a fanatical Roman Catholic, so the wholesome horniness seems to have been like a real part of her in-life persona as well.
I guess so, yeah.
Anyhow, she certainly used to good effect with John Garfield in this movie as this romance, and how beautiful they are is the spoonful of sugar that helps this bitter pill go down.
But there's so much sugar in this movie. That's the fascinating thing about it, right? And that's what makes
it... Well, I remembered it as being much grimmer than it was on a second viewing.
That's right. That's right. Because again, this is, I would say, the ultimate, well, either this or Juke Girl. These are the two ultimate popular front films.
So what does Garfield appearing first memorably in Four Daughters in 1938 and still playing very much that same character here, what does Garfield represent in contrast to what the pre-code Cagney represents?
Well, basically he represents an opportunity for the New Deal and for an even newer deal that's more effective and more wide-ranging in its effort.
So you don't want the Joker anymore. You don't want the nihilist, the determined revolutionary. You want this alienated young man who can be
brought back into the fold because the American dream is for every single person, right? That's the idea. And the American dream is socialism. And that's what the Popular Front message is.
And the Popular Front is very friendly towards small business in this movie.
Of course
it is. Which
is
interesting.
Of course it is, right? Because the idea is we're not going to try to rile up class conflict. We're going to bring everyone in on a joint mission to improve everyone's quality of life. It's certainly not Marxist at all, right? And you could take issue with any of it or all of it if you want to on political grounds or theoretical grounds, and I might not disagree, but it does have immense appeal. And certainly, look, I can't look askance at this too much because this is the kind of stuff that formed my political opinions when I was a kid. Right? Watching these Warner Brothers movies helped me to become a leftist, and I may have gone further and read Marx and read Gramsci, and I know all kinds of things that I wouldn't have known just based on watching some stories stories like this, and I might have some disagreements with the possibility that the Popular Front could have ever worked out, but I do look kindly upon these efforts of these communist writers like Robert Rawson and what they were trying to get into popular entertainment.
And of course, it also does help that it's just fucking entertaining.
It's incredibly entertaining, and it presents such a wonderful, you know, vision of humanity.
And it's such a contrast in terms of, like, top-notch, glossy Hollywood filmmaking. I mean, it just shows you how much more there can be to that than MGM's vision. Not that, you know, I mean, I love MGM, but it's not my favorite studio.
No, this is the best studio. Look, there's a lot you need to say, we need to say, about all the ways that the New Deal fell short. These criticisms are all valid. You know, you can find them in any kind of argument that you might see even on Twitter about the New Deal. It didn't go nearly far enough, and it left a lot of people behind, right? It was absolutely pretty much useless for...
But it's supposed to be a stepping stone, isn't it? For someone from Robert Rawson's perspective?
Yeah, of course it was.
It's supposed to become more inclusive.
Well, that's the idea, yeah. Now, could it ever have, given the political situation in the Democratic Party at the time? I think there is a lot of reason to suppose that no, it couldn't have, right? Because the Democrats were depending on the votes from the Solid South, which was a segregationist society.
Right.
And the people that they needed to placate wanted to make sure that nothing really happened to help Black people in America. And for the most part, they succeeded, right? So the New Deal didn't do much for the people that were in the absolute worst position in America. The people it helped the most were, you know, quote-unquote ethnic whites.
Of which we see some here.
Absolutely, right? These are Warner Brothers people. That's right. Who most of their star actors
were. Well, I mean, there, you know, there's the Jewish Garfield, and there's the explicitly Italian business owner, diner owner.
Yeah, Henry Armetta, a wonderful actor.
Yeah.
So great in this movie, Nick.
So shall we start talking about the movie?
Yeah. So we meet Joe Bell as he is just sort of casually informed after serving 13 months in prison that, oh, it was all a mistake. Sorry. You know, we convicted you. We were wrong. The person that actually did it confessed. So, all right, have a good life. No wrongful imprisonment lawsuit for Joe Bell. None of that. He's just thrown out into the same old mess.
Right. And his philosophy, the depression, is I'm a nobody. That's why you treated me this way. And that's how I will always be treated.
Yeah, and I don't see any reason to think he's wrong.
It's obviously, having just rewatched it recently and talked about it on the podcast, obviously there's a very interesting compare and contrast with I'm a Fugitive from a Chain Gang.
Very much so. That's how I bookended my essay, right? I'm a Fugitive from a Chain Gang is the start of the essay, and this is the end, where so many other possibilities become available thanks to a change in government and a change in perspective on the part of the left. But at the beginning, he's dealing with the same old problem, the same thing that Paul Muni was dealing with, except he's in an even worse position. He doesn't even have a minister as a brother. He just has no brother. He has nothing. No mother either. He's a tramp, and this is the Great Depression. He's got his friends that he picks up along the way. These are two of the dead-end kids.
Right.
They're great, too.
Yeah, not in their own movies, but in other movies, they're great.
Well, they always have a little something, you know? But when it's just them...
Gets a bit cloying.
Often it does, yeah. But as elements of other movies, they're terrific. Obviously, yeah. Dead End itself is an amazing movie. Angels with Dirty Faces. Even They Made Me a Criminal.
Right.
The Garfield film. These little guys, you know, they're just looking for jobs. They're doing the Paul Muni thing, tramping across the country. And here we're presumably in the late 1930s. Situation is even worse. Not working out. We get our first encounter with, you know, Robert Rawson's vision of a helpful good neighbor. A fellow citizen who is looking to do what they can to lessen the load on these poor guys.
Right.
So that's Charlie Grapewin, the brakeman.
Right, and all of this involves... All of these acts of Good Samaritanism involves breaking rules.
Breaking laws.
Which culminates... Yeah. Well, this is just the rule of the company.
Yes, but it's also breaking the law to not... These are vagrants, right? They are trespassing officially on property. So it's also breaking the law.
And this culminates in, of course, what Nick does for the two of them.
Yeah, well, we'll get to that. But here it's just looking the other way when you notice that some people who really need to get somewhere are on your train. They're not hurting anyone. Now, this is not a utopia, right? So it's like a David Lynch world of really stark good and bad, right? And you have some really just completely broken, monstrous people.
Oh, yeah, Priscilla Lane's stepfather, who's just, I have his good side and his bad side. He's like a demonic...
Yes.
Prototype of Night of the Hunter, Robert Mitchum, Night of the Hunter.
Yeah, well, we'll get to him. So we're on the train. We get these people who are basically Bogarts from the Roaring Twenties, except much further down the crime food chain. Ward Bond and whoever it is that's with him. So that's Bert the Cop from It's a Wonderful Life, playing that monstrous, huge thug that John Garfield is
fighting
with.
Well, yeah, okay, so this is an interesting contrast to the Cagney protagonist, which is that it's important that Garfield is not a criminal.
No, he's not at all. Right. He's just wrongfully accused. He's a born suspect.
Other than being a vagrant, which is, I guess, criminal.
Well, yeah, exactly. And this movie makes a big point of that, right? If we're going to stick to the letter of the law, every person hopping a train in America right now is a hardened criminal. Do you really believe that? Or do you want to change some laws?
Right. And so this the judge that they all end up before after this fight with these bad guys on the train, he's a real piece of work, this judge.
He is. But I do think it's important, right, that we see that there are some real terrible people roaming the world as well. The Ward Bond character. He's trying to choke Bobby Jordan to stop him from coughing so that they don't get arrested. And I guess that could have been done totally differently, but they want you to think this guy is a demon. Right? He's willing to kill Bobby Jordan just to shut him up. And after that...
I mean, you do kind of see... Well, Chain Gang is interesting in that you see these real criminals, since some of them are basically demonic, and yet it's all they all kind of become friends. There's no...
Oh, yeah.
There's no division within the prison between the people who deserve to be there, quote-unquote, and don't deserve to be there.
Analogous figure, I guess, although he's a lot more charming, is Preston Foster, the guy that convinces Paul Muni to go to the hamburger joint and then uses him as an accomplice. He's a thoroughgoing baddie.
Yeah.
Of course, he just gets killed. But Ward Bond, he's such a weasel and he's so resentful and spiteful that after they get arrested, he tries to implicate Garfield and the dead-end kids.
Presumably, this is the path that John Garfield could go down.
Right. If he gets too embittered, I don't know, he could become Ward Bond and
that
would be a terrible thing.
No Priscilla Lane. He's right on that trajectory.
It's hard to imagine this character ever becoming so spiteful that he goes out of his way to try to get someone else sent to jail for no reason.
Well, you have to assume if the movie has a social message, the social message is not that some people are born demonic.
No, this guy has just been turned so bad that he's even willing to do this petty thing. And the only reason that he's not able to actually succeed in doing it is that Charlie Grapewind speaks up and probably gets fired or forced to retire.
Yeah, luckily he seems to have a backup life.
Yeah, I love that actor. We've seen him in lots of things. You know, he's probably most famous as Uncle Henry from The Wizard of Oz the same year.
Sure.
But he's also so good in Petrified Forest. He's old Gramp.
Right.
A much less benign character in that movie. But here he's just a wonderful voice of left-wing wisdom.
It also does seem, I mean, I think this is often said, probably, but the continuity of the character actors in Warner Brothers. There's people who just keep going and going and going.
Absolutely, and we're going to meet a bunch of them in this movie.
And probably would you say that like maybe no other studio has the same roster of character actors?
A lot of them have very consistent casts, right? Think of Paramount. Think of all those Preston Sturges.
Paramount is the other studio I was thinking of, but I'm not sure if it's quite as across the board with people just showing up in everybody's movies being plugged into really effective roles, but that's debatable.
It is. Now, I think they're all pretty good at this, but Warner Brothers, you could certainly make a case that they're the best, that they have the best lineup of character actors for the types of movies that they were putting together. They're not getting sent to Sing Sing, so maximum security or anything like that. They're getting sent to a prison farm, which is certainly bad enough. I never want anything to do with this. But it's the milder sentence, and they get that because Charlie Grapewind intervenes and says, no, they're not involved in anything except for riding on the train. So I guess you're going to have to sentence them for that, but that's all you can possibly sentence them for, or I guess fighting on the train. It's 30 days for the dead-end kids, and it's 90 days for Garfield because he has committed contempt of court.
He mouthed off.
Yeah. We get the speech immediately from Stanley Ridges, who has that two sides to my nature. He is on the booze quite often, and I guess that's when his Mr. Hyde side comes out the most.
Although there's nothing in the script to suggest this, and there's nothing in Priscilla Lane's performance to suggest it. Just the fact that he's her stepfather and he's such a fucking creep gives you all sorts of creeps about their potential relationship.
Whatever is going on, it's not a happy home, that's for sure.
The meet cute with Priscilla Lane and John Garfield is fascinating because it goes from physical comedy with comedy music in the background to kind of a sexy moment where he's shoving her and she's slapping him, and then immediately into horror when her stepdad shows up.
So he gets thrown around by a cow. She makes fun of him, but she's clearly interested in him.
Then he's super defensive, though.
He is, and he gets fresh, and she smacks him really hard. Like, it just doesn't seem...
He really grabs her and shoves her, and it's kind of hot, but...
Well, it certainly was meant to be.
They're a great pair.
They really are, yeah.
Well, he doesn't hurt her, but then she slaps the shit out of him.
Yeah, she really hits him hard. Or they do a good job of convincing you that she hit him hard.
But just at the moment where I'm going like, ooh, this is kind of hot, then everything changes.
Stepdad shows up and sends him to the rock pile to burn in the sun. And he talks about, look, I feel bad for you. That's the good side of my nature.
But I'm going to keep doing it, and that's the bad side.
Keep away from that girl.
So the good side is really useless.
It's not very helpful, no. It just allows him to ruminate on the bad deeds that he commits, I guess. John Garfield obviously is pretty pissed off at Priscilla Lane and says a lot of nasty things to her whenever he has a chance because she put him in this position. And it's only when he finds out that she broke ranks and went above the dad's head to the actual warden, William B. Davidson, classic Warner Brothers actor, who knows that the foreman is a problem and gives John Garfield a better job. And then it becomes kind of an idol.
Yeah, but it's an idol within a context of horror that's about to close in on them again.
I know. Well, that's the pattern of this film, right? It's a real roller coaster ride because you keep seeing little opportunities, little spaces for happiness opening up, and then something else happens to fuck it up. And this is the first one.
Right.
Where everyone's kind of happy on this prison farm. They meet Charlie Grapewind again when they're on a trip into the city to get some groceries for the farm. He gives them some of his wisdom.
Yeah, it's like society. You could have a really shitty job in it, but if you get the cushy job and you have a girl...
It's not so bad.
Other than the fact that they can't exactly start a family.
Not yet, no. But they're planning, right? And they're acknowledging that they're engaged and he has 22 days left to serve. So all of that got done in 68 days. That's where they are. They're on a haystack kissing. And again, discovered by the evil stepdad. And now he's livid and he hurts his daughter. He's planning to get revenge on John Garfield, and Garfield has to intervene. Of course, we've heard about his whiskey heart already, and you kind of just know what's going to happen here.
Right. And then Garfield wants them to run because he can't imagine that he will be exonerated.
And of course, you pointed out, what about the coroner? Wouldn't he have...
Well, by the end of the movie, because it never gets brought up in the trial, I was wondering, why would there not be a coroner's report saying whether it was head trauma or heart trouble that killed him?
Yeah, but we get some testimony, and I guess we have to assume some of it was off screen. They would have talked to a doctor at some point. But the fact that they ran is bad for them.
Right.
According to the legal system, right? If you're present when someone dies, you're supposed to be reporting it, not running to another state. So they're chasing them for that reason,
and
if for nothing else.
It's very hard. I mean, I tend to side with Garfield here and think that he would have been fucked, so I find his running sympathetic.
Well, of course, and you're supposed to, right? But you're supposed to also see...
I mean, already he didn't do anything to be put in this prison farm in the first place.
It's a three-ply fucking over.
And this is, he's in a state where he could get the death penalty.
Yeah. So Priscilla Lane then, and at several points subsequently, is voicing the hope that this must be a world where people are going to give you the benefit of the doubt and let you start your life over.
Well, her point is valid too. His point is valid in that he'll probably be fucked. Her point is valid in that you're fucked anyway, so you need to take a chance because you cannot keep running for the rest of your life.
Right. But he's saying, no, that's exactly what we're going to do.
It's interesting, her character in this one, usually she plays a bourgeois character in contrast to him. I don't really know what her status would be as this...
No, she seems like one of life's losers as well, right? She's the stepdaughter of this not very well respected prison farm corrections officer.
So yeah, it's not the world's most glamorous job that he has.
No, and they don't seem to be really well off. Doesn't have any money to take with her or anything.
So we don't really know where her shiny optimism comes from here. here. That's maybe a bit of a aporia in the movie.
Or she's already read some Communist Party material.
I feel like her backstory is that she's been molested by her stepfather, but on the other hand, we don't see that, so maybe she's just optimistic because she's never been put in prison.
Right, well, that's a start.
Maybe just dealing with a drunken asshole of a stepdad, even if he's not molesting you, is bad enough.
It's bad, there's no question about that, but she hasn't been misunderstood on numerous occasions by different representatives of the government. And that's certainly what Garfield is dealing with. Their flight takes them, okay, the first place that they get to, they need to get a hotel room, and there's a moment where she's like, well, we can't do that. And he says, well, of course we're going to get married first.
Oh, they get the milk, the free milk from the milkman?
That's right.
This is on the shareholders?
Yeah, that little guy, he's in every Capra movie. This is their honeymoon. What are they, ducks? I don't know the actor's name, though. I really should.
You're talking about It's a Wonderful Life.
Yeah. But in this movie, he's the milkman. Then they go to get married, and a weird thing happens here. They don't get the marriage that they want, but they sort of get showered with furnished home and a bunch of other necessities of life.
Right, and Garfield still nearly explodes because this is such a humiliating position for them that they have to get married in front of basically a reality TV audience.
Absolutely, that's what it is, right?
Except it's a live show.
Yeah. And Frank McHugh is the one that brings him in on that. And so he's like the most ambiguous benefactor because he's actually exploiting them.
Right.
Or his company is.
Well, no, this is not goodwill that he has
but
here.
But he's jovial. He's like, oh, don't go in there. I've got a better deal for you. You need a house, don't you? You need food.
And yeah, and I mean, the thesis statement here, or the proposition being put to the audience is, why can't these sweet, attractive young people just have this? Just, like, have a nice apartment and a job and some kids? Like,
no, they've got to make a spectacle. They have to make spectacles of themselves in order to get it.
No, but I mean, even afterwards. That's what I mean. When they've reconciled themselves to that, and it looks like they're a little bit set up for the future. Why can't they? Wouldn't that be part of the popular front message? Why can't we all just have the basic necessities of life? Because inside we're all as sweet and sexy as this lovely young couple here.
Yeah.
And as Priscilla Lane keeps saying, we have a right to live, we have a right to have kids, we have a right to a home. All of those things that, like, nobody has anymore. Like, millennials, just middle-class millennials don't even have a right to kids in a home anymore.
Yeah, they have a right to their parents' basement for as long as that lasts.
Or, you know, to their own basement, like us.
But, of course, the problem that comes along with all of this is that they're photographed on numerous occasions, and that's not going to help them to remain incognito, and they wind up having to run away again. They take refuge with Henry Armetta, the wonderful Italian restaurant owner, and that's a situation where they meet him because they can't pay their bill. Garfield goes up to him and tries to toss him for the amount of the check.
But he's really angling for the guy giving them, well, allowing them to work it off, and or, if they're really lucky, getting jobs with him.
Yeah, exactly. And it works out perfectly.
You know, it's so similar and yet so different politically from Borzage's vision in Little Man, What Now?
Well, yeah. Yeah, I agree. And that's why you can see there's like a weird... Borzage and Capra, they both feel like they should be closer to socialism than they are.
And Rawson also clearly in this movie hates the government, so there's no difference there.
Well, for people like Rawson and the Popular Front, it's a love-hate, right? Because they want to love the government. They want a government they can love.
Yeah.
Borzage just hates the government. And he doesn't care what government it is, I don't think.
I mean, I don't know. Maybe to an impartial viewer who didn't know anything about the politics or the political context of those two movies, this one and Little Man, What Now, maybe it wouldn't read any differently, because the way I read this, knowing something about Rawson, is that a lot of it is pandering. A lot of it is, I'm putting this in a way that I think will sell to the average American,
right?
Like all the stuff about Garfield needing his pride and Garfield needing to get a break and earn a job. Well, he needs a break, but he's going to get a job on his own merits.
Yeah.
Right? He's not going to get a handout.
Right. Because he's programmed to think that that is a disaster.
And the movie is supporting him in this. Although not supporting him in committing a crime or a murder in order to avoid begging.
Right. So they have another idyll with Henry Armetta, but unfortunately that one comes to an end as well because the police come calling. Armetta just does everything for them. I mean, he protects their identities as best he can. He says that they don't work there anymore.
They
still find Priscilla Lane and arrest her.
I mean, this goes beyond plausibility, well beyond plausibility, what he does for these people he doesn't even know. I mean, a lot of things do, like Alan Hale accepting, just believing John Garfield, who he's just met, is not a murderer.
Well, again, this is the vision of humanity that Rawson is putting forth. This is the kind of understanding that needs to exist between human beings in the new world.
Right, the people who have their slice of the pie or whatever.
They need to help others. Yeah. And that's exactly what Armetta says.
Not just help, but understand, like you're saying.
Well, yeah, both. Armetta says, I came here as an immigrant. I had nothing. Someone helped me. I need to do that for others. Of course, you're not expecting that's going to extend to being an accomplice to a jailbreak. That is what it amounts to.
It practically turns into Miracle of Morgan's Creek / bringing a baby at that point.
Right. And again, the movie is very carefully making sure that this is not like a gritty prison shootout.
Right.
It's Garfield uses his ingenuity to trick these goofy jail officials, the matron and this after hours guy. And he just tells them, hey, I got a camera here. I'm going to take pictures of you with this dame. And of course, that's all they need to hear. He doesn't need to use violence, just the slightest threat of it to get his wife out of there. And they go on the lam again. And in the meantime, he's acquired a camera.
Right, I guess with the $70 he had in the bank that Nick gets out, or that Nick lends him in order to, against the $70 he has in the bank.
Yeah, he needs this as his prop.
This is kind of an ingenious bit of plotting here, getting us from one step to the next.
So wonderful.
Yeah, then we have the scene where he's ready to go and steal at gunpoint instead of Big. And, of course, this is one of the most... This is like Rawson just, it feels like, drawing on the whole library of Warner Brothers ethnic movies, right? Starting from the early 30s. In order to draw this very broad, sentimental portrait of this ethnic, I guess in this case, Jewish shop owner that is extraordinarily effective.
Yeah, that actress is wonderful. I don't know her name either, but she's in Bachelor Mother, and she's wonderful in that as well. She's Ginger Rogers' best friend in the apartment, right, who helps her.
Yeah, I was just obviously brought to tears here.
It's like a candy store.
Sit down. Delicatessen. Sit down. I'm going to make you sandwiches. And I keep, in my head, I'm just like... And then he's going to bring some of the sandwiches home. And it's, like, horrible that he leaves without the sandwiches and the jam.
Yeah, but he just feels so awful that he came in there to torment this woman or scare her.
But it's important that I think that you also feel awful that he doesn't get the food.
Of course, of course. And that's what she wants.
And I don't, from this point, when he's selling the camera, and fortuitously, but also by risking his life, wins that job at the newspaper... I don't know what they're living on. Maybe he's been selling photos like the one he offers to take of the pawnbroker. I don't know what's happening in the stretch of time after that.
Just scraping by, probably dodging the landlady.
I don't know, I guess.
Paying the rent.
Or I don't know what the timing of it is. Maybe he's supposed to sell the camera the next day. I don't know.
They do have fights, right? There are two.
Quite a lot.
Important fights. One of them is earlier on when she just doesn't want to walk anymore. She's too tired. She wants to take a break. She's like, what difference does it make whether it takes us 4 hours or 2 hours to get there? We're not even going to be able to stay anyway. I'm going to sit down. And he just keeps nagging her to get up and she won't. And then they're like, oh, well, forget it then. We're just going to leave it there. And she decides to hitchhike the opposite way, but then she doesn't. And they have their reconciliation.
Well, I mean, it's important that they are having this conflict all along, given what's ultimately going to be the resolution.
There's a lot of friction between them, right? Not a totally saccharine portrait of lovers on the run who are just in agreement on everything.
It's beyond that. It's like highly romantic that they end up staying together despite having all this conflict.
Exactly. And that's something that viewers would have recognized from their other two films, right? There's a lot of friction or ideological disagreement or whatever, however you want to put it, between Priscilla Lane and Garfield's character in both of the daughters' films.
And of course, she's that girl, blonde girl next door character who's also very strong-willed, probably more strong-willed than he is.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. She is really the one that's keeping them on any kind of straight and narrow here that makes it possible for him to be redeemed by the end, because otherwise he would have started doing something too crazy.
I was thinking in this movie, what a conventional role, of course, that is for the female character to have. To be the, again, sort of like Little Man, What Now? The reason for living and the one who keeps the man from becoming completely nihilistic. But that's okay. It's okay that Warner Brothers sometimes portrays women this way and does gender this way, because they're also the best at the woman's picture.
They are. And this is a great role for Priscilla Lane. In the Roaring Twenties, not as much, although a great showcase for her singing talent.
Yeah.
This movie, I think, really gives her a lot to do.
For sure, for sure.
Maybe not quite as much as Four Daughters or Daughters Courageous, but right up there. So their last benefactor is Alan Hale.
Oh, what a great role for Alan Hale this is. He's so great in this.
Well, you know, he never lets you down, but he comes out of nowhere, right? You might be thinking, well, where's Alan Hale? He's usually got a much bigger part in a movie if he's listed in the cast, but he shows up right at the end. And
course, Alan Hale can be very unpleasant.
He can do anything.
Yeah.
All within somehow not seeming that different, but
nope.
Very different inflections. He just gives you the exactly right.
And Alan Hale is, of course, in Little Man What Now.
He is. And he's very ambiguous in that film.
Yeah, but here he's not so much ambiguous. He's a bumbling boss.
I don't know if he's so much bumbling.
Oh, come on. That stuff about locking the darkroom door and unlock. That's great. It's a great bit of business.
Yeah, he's really excited because they've got the photos of the decade, right? These are pretty incredible pictures because Garfield just happened to be there.
That's a great sequence, right? Where they're firing at him as he's taking the pictures and he's willing to die.
He is, because he's got no choice. He's got to do something to set himself apart. And here it is. Finally, his chance. All he has to do is be willing to take a bullet.
Yeah,
for
that's all.
Some incredible shots of like a G-Man style robbery, like a Bonnie and Clyde insane broad daylight bank heist. He tells Garfield, I'll get you $30 a week plus a bonus and maybe like a couple $1,000 from the newswire services.
Oh yeah, and at that point you're just like, oh fuck, let him just get the money, please.
But you know, here we've got the same problem that Peter Parker has as Spider-Man. He can't actually collect a check. He can't take a reward into the bank because he'd have to sign his name. Garfield can't take public credit for it, and he has to explain to Alan Hale why that is. What is he doing? Why doesn't he want his biography and his picture shown all over the world? And okay, maybe you find that not that believable that a boss would bend over backwards and listen to these kids' story.
At all believable. I guess I have John Garfield's view of human nature.
But again, the movie makes you believe while you're watching it, I think, that this could happen, and this is the kind of thing that people will do for each other if they are attuned to each other in the way that we should be.
Alan Hale seems to be willing to stand up to big-time gangsters in order to put them away for their crimes.
Yeah.
So I guess maybe, sure.
Yeah, exactly.
He's a bit heroic.
Garfield here, this is the finale. They save quite a crescendo in terms of action for him because he has to run out into the street, jump into this mobster car, and wrestle with the guy for the steering wheel to save his boss. And of course they all wind up in the hospital, and here Priscilla Lane just can't handle it anymore, and she is staking everything on this new country that America is becoming thanks to Franklin Delano Roosevelt.
But she's like, there is no choice but to hope at this point. There is no choice.
That's right.
Or you can be Paul Mooney and disappear into the dark. I steal.
That's right. And that's what Warner Brothers recommended in 1932, and here they're recommending the reverse. It's time for us to start trying to trust each other.
Even if things fail
sometimes, we have to try again and try to work together.
Come out of the shadows.
Exactly. The courtroom scene, I think it's amazing. It is didactic, obviously.
Oh, I liked it.
It's so good. And Maroni Olson, wonderful performer as well.
The whole movie is didactic.
Absolutely. And in the best way. But the defense attorney, I think he's so good, lays out the stakes for America outside of the movie. What does it mean?
The fact that he kind of gives his closing speech before introducing his last witness, he's just allowed to do that.
Yeah, sure. And the only one that can tell you that is Priscilla Lane. And yeah, it's a great, great speech for her too. She really plays it perfectly. It doesn't get histrionic.
Nope.
I mean, she's upset and it shows, but she really does a great job in explaining what they've been through. And it all works out.
The jury of my not peers, as Garfield explains, right, does decide that he's innocent. Or at least there is a reasonable doubt.
Yeah, well, and the movie just basically makes it seem like, okay, life can now begin for these people and hopefully for the whole country someday.
So I guess here we're looking at not the reconciliation between the rich and the working class that was popular in 1930s comedies.
No, and I think it's very important important that that's not what this is.
It's a reconciliation between the, I don't know, the social outsider, the social loser, the loser of the system, and
the system.
And the system, the bourgeoisie.
Yeah, it's a shame it just didn't work out. The New Deal never got any better. I guess under Lyndon B. Johnson, the Great Society was a sort of development after the 50s kind of stalled everything, but then it all fell apart and has just been getting worse and worse ever since.
I mean, we're all very happy for, in North America, we're all very happy for whatever healthcare we have.
Sure, but...
I mean, government-provided healthcare we're talking about here, or government-facilitated healthcare.
It could be worse, but it could be a million times better by now. And certainly Robert Rawson, I don't think, would be very pleased. Oh, one aspect before we go that we didn't mention, we talked about all of the incredible contributions from the Warner Brothers team, leaving out the director, who we don't really have any sense of, but one person we didn't mention was Max Steiner, because the Dust Be My Destiny score is great, too.
Sure, and also, who but Max Steiner would be putting that little comedy jingle in the background during the cow scene.
Sure.
So, Splendor in the Grass.
Right, we saw that as part of the very small retrospective on Natalie Wood films. We didn't get a chance to see the others. There were only three,
well,
though.
Well, everything keeps getting interrupted by COVID.
That's right.
Were there more than three planned originally? This
no.
is at TIFF Lightbox again?
No, it was just three, so I don't know what
well, everything's
was going
fucked
on
up by COVID.
Yeah.
What was going on? COVID. So I'd never seen this before. I didn't really have any interest in seeing it. You made me see it. So I liked it. What this most reminded me of in terms of both the extreme depiction of sexuality and the accompanying style was actually Fire Walk With Me.
Well, there's no doubt that Lynch loves this movie.
You think so?
And I feel like he must love Natalie Wood. I mean, he cast her daughter in Lost Highway.
It's interesting that this movie garnered a lot of respect in Hollywood, and Fire Walk With Me certainly didn't, and I wonder if that's just because of the presentation, even though there's by no means like a quote-unquote realistic movie, it is very stylistically extreme. The presentation of it as realistic and a sociological study, maybe that has something to do with the different reception, and also the fact that in the early 60s this was just the respectable topic, sexual repression.
Well, yeah, but it was rated X, I think, when
really?
It came out.
It's an original screenplay by William Inge. He did win for Best Original Screenplay, and Natalie Wood was nominated, and certainly Sheryl Lee should have been nominated for Fire Walk With Me, but I don't know, different circumstances.
Very different. This movie, I had only seen it once. When I cast my mind back, I realized that, yeah, it was when I was a teenager watching it on the black and white TV in my room, so I never even had seen it in color. But the one scene that always stuck with me and made me think I love this movie is the scene where she realizes that Bud has cheated on her.
Yeah, you told me that as we were going into the movie, the classroom scene, and yeah, that was pretty powerful.
The teacher is badgering her to present an interpretation of William Wordsworth's poem.
That's
it's
when she
such
starts...
an incredible performance. I think other people, there are many other great moments for her in the film. People will certainly talk about the bathtub scene, but for me, her greatest achievement is that classroom scene.
Yeah, it's less,
so
it's less
great.
Extreme.
Yeah.
In the bathtub scene, she just seems like she's demonically possessed.
It's really good, too, though. I don't want to take anything away from it, but just the sort of measured hysteria that she gives you in that classroom scene,
yeah,
is
she really,
matchless.
She and, I guess, Kazan really give her places to go, places still to go, because it's going to get more extreme yet, right?
Yeah, and this is a very important turning point in Natalie Wood's career, right? She had been a child star.
Well, I was thinking of this as like the ultimate example of the female child star transition movie that you start getting in the 60s, but she had been making playing adult roles and sexy roles for quite a while before this.
Yeah, but I think this was a new bar that she was asked to meet.
Or wanted to meet.
Of course. No, she wanted it. I mean, the material demanded it of her. She wanted to try to meet it and raise her game, and it seemed like it worked, because the 60s were a good decade for Natalie Wood.
The final piece in the puzzle for me... Hey, maybe this is the kind of thing Priscilla Lane would have liked to do. Although that's not wouldn't have been possible in the 40s. But the final piece of the puzzle for me in understanding and appreciating Fire Walk With Me was when I watched this little Lynch documentary, and the way he talked about his teenage years made me realize the continuity between Blue Velvet and Fire Walk With Me, and the fact that Fire Walk With Me is like this intensification of him dealing with his own, with his teenage sexuality, right? And his shame over it.
Yeah.
And the intensity of it. So basically that he was Laura Palmer, which made me much more sympathetic to the film than thinking that this was some kind of external exploitative point of view, right?
Right.
I was feeling the same way about this performance and this character. Like, why is the female character presented that way? And I'm like, well, I guess if the author, William Inge, I guess if he was really, really struggling with his sexuality, then it would make sense that he would put that into the female character, right? Rather than the male character. And it turns out that yes, in fact, he was, that he was a deeply conflicted homosexual who ultimately, when his career went south, ended up committing suicide.
Yeah, in the 70s, I guess. Because he was basically the biggest thing other than Tennessee Williams in the theater in the 50s and into the 60s, right?
1973.
Yeah.
Tennessee Williams, actually the same thing happened to him, but he held on a little longer.
Right.
And didn't overtly commit suicide, although, you know, he drank like hell.
Was Tennessee Williams out?
Sounds like William Inge, like this was like an enormous part of his personality that he was so ashamed
right.
of his homosexuality. Tennessee Williams, I guess he would have been out in his circles.
Right, right.
His artistic circles. And I'm sure he had some shame over, because who didn't?
Well, like everything in society was designed to make you feel ashamed.
Yeah, but it doesn't seem to have been a central component of his personality or anything.
Right, yeah.
So yeah, I mean, there's definitely real parallels there. David Lynch was just, you know, generally from a middle-class, somewhat religious home. And that in itself is apparently enough to produce enormous conflict over your developing libido.
Yeah.
Even if you're not homosexual. But yeah, so things were pretty intense for William Inge.
Yeah, and they get intense in this movie.
But I mean, I could 100% identify with this. I don't think there are any lies told here. I think between the age of 18 and 25, I pretty much felt like I was demonically possessed. And this is what I found fascinating watching the movie, that it's not just like societal repression is making this way worse, but sexuality itself is a demonic force. It's just overpowering and impersonal, and it cannot be contained within polite society.
The movie doesn't really give you any good options, right?
Well, them getting married would have prevented her descending into insanity.
Right, but no, that's not possible because of the obstacles there.
So is the father.
The obstacle is mainly the father, yeah, definitely. And just the capitalist system and everything that is supporting the father's position there and his power over his family. That father, Pat Hingle, what a crazy actor. You know, unfortunately, one of the things I know him best from is The Incredible World of Horace Ford, maybe the most insane, annoying Twilight Zone episode ever recorded. He plays that toy designer who's kind of reverting to childhood. Sort of a time travel story. It's quite fascinating, but also really hard to watch because he's a million times more annoying in that than he is in this one. Except he's talking about toys all the time.
No, I think he's perfect in this.
Oh, no, he's a great actor. I mean, he does exactly what's required. He's supposed to be unbelievably overbearing.
Exactly.
And he is.
Yeah. And Warren Beatty is interesting in this.
I think he's wonderful in this movie.
He's kind of doing it Brando, but like really quiet and internalized.
Yeah.
Very, very internalized, as opposed to the increasing externalization of Natalie Wood.
Yeah, I really was impressed by Beatty in this.
Oh, film. He's a good actor.
Well, of course, but this is his first film role. And yeah. I wasn't sure. I didn't remember thinking back over the 30 years. Was he good in this or not? Yeah, he's really good in it.
Yeah, these are incredible young actors. Obviously, he lets her be the central figure.
But we should not forget about the sister.
Mm.
That is a great role.
Yeah, he lets them be the central figures.
Yeah.
So yeah, this is another woman, young woman, dealing with societal sexual repression in her own way. Instead of trying to kill herself, she's just... It's very much like the Dorothy Malone character Written on the Wind, but in such a different register.
Yeah, there's a lot of similarities to Cirque.
And Barbara Loden. Lynn is great. She's a wild performer.
Yeah, that scene where her brother comes in to try to talk her out of going out with the bootlegger and she smacks him in the face and then regrets it.
Oh,
it's so good.
God.
That's one of the best scenes in the movie.
Beatty just plays so well off of these women, and he is just so, but he's passive in front of everybody.
Yeah, he's getting pushed around by his dad. I mean, everyone is, but you know, he's not a cipher. He's just very internalized.
Well, he's suffering from the same sexual torments of hell as Natalie Wood, but he ultimately, although he doesn't want to, ultimately he has and can choose an outlet. Although choosing an outlet doesn't seem to have helped Barbara Loden.
No, exactly. And that's what I think, you know, the movie is basically saying in this climate, whether you choose to rebel or not rebel, it's not going to work out anyway.
The girl who sleeps, like the incipient flapper who sleeps with Beatty, she seems to be fine.
I love her. She's so good in this movie. I listened to a podcast on the film this week, Hollywoodography, and they noticed exactly the same thing I noticed. Maybe everyone who sees this movie thinks this. She's a dead ringer for Molly Ringwald.
Ha ha!
It's so weird.
That's hilarious.
And I looked up the actress. It's pretty sad. She had an aneurysm the next year.
Oh my god.
And she didn't die right away, but basically she was kind of incapacitated from like 24 onward.
So I guess this is saying that not everybody is going to impale themselves on the stake of sexual repression, but
most people will.
But most people will. Yeah, one way or the other, and especially women. No matter, there's no happy solution for many women.
Yeah, and we won't get into too much detail because for these Fear and Moviegoing, we're just giving very general overviews. Everything, I loved this movie. I loved it so much more than I expected to. I mean, I remembered thinking it was really good when I was 15. But that was 33 years ago.
Right.
So.
It's terrifying, though.
It is. It is. And it's not for everyone. Certainly a lot of people reviewing it just think it's out of hand. And well, Kazan went crazy. And
if you like Fire Walk With Me, give this a try.
Oh, yeah. And you got a Phyllis Diller appearance as the same basic character that Gladys George is playing.
And
in
how
the
is that?
20s.
How is that for the final interaction between father and son?
Getting his son a chorus girl.
This could have been one of our, yeah, and in that particular way.
It's so sick.
This could have been one of our family freakout movies. Well, it fits right in there with the whole hysterical 50s/early 60s family melodramas with Cirque and Nicholas Ray. And
yeah, I agree. And probably in the 2030s, when we're scheduling more episodes, I will bring this in somehow so we can do a full episode on it. But for now, definitely seek out Splendor in the Grass if this sounds enticing to you. And next week, Elise, it's back to the Daniel Day-Lewis Actorist Oeuvre Review. This is going to be a big one. It's The Age of Innocence and In the Name of the Father.
Oh yeah, this should be pretty substantial.